What's up, New Hope family? Welcome to New Hope here. Welcome to The Lobby. My name is David. I am our online campus director, host of The Lobby. I'm so excited that you're here. I'm excited that my friend Hattie is here.
Hello.
This is going to be a good episode.
I'm not used to this
thing. No, we're in a different setting for The Lobby this week. We have Michael on producer cam as well. Hi, Michael.
Hi,
Michael,
everyone.
Could you please just repeat the thing that I did?
We are, for those of you who don't recognize where we are, shame on you. We're very upset.
Calling out.
That's what we do here at The Lobby. We shame people and call them out. No, this is our podcast set. At least it has been. We'll see how things go in the future. If you've been joining us, you know things are crazy in our building right now, so things are moving around. But this has been our podcast set, Pastor Mike's podcast, The Grow Podcast.
It's very good. If you haven't checked it out, check it out.
Thank you.
Yeah,
that was a great spiel for...
Thank you.
If you're hearing really loud noises, those are the people fixing our roof still.
So. It's funny because last week we also had really loud noises.
We did. They were fixing a different roof, it seemed, at the baseball field. This is fun. It's a cool spot.
Yeah. Nice space.
But it's, you know, it's not like a barbecue restaurant.
It's no smell month.
Yeah, it is no smell month.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, there is no smell in the podcast room at the moment.
Which is good. It's probably, that's a good thing.
Definitely a good thing.
We'll see. We have about 8 minutes left, so we'll see if that lasts for 8 minutes.
I'm concerned about this now.
Yeah.
I think I'll just duck out. See you guys later.
Oh man, and I wonder if we're gonna sound better. We should sound better in these mics, right? Than
like
our normal
really
lapels.
Good.
Yeah. So all of this gold content that we're providing right now will sound extra crisp for everybody at the lobby.
If we've ever wanted content to sound good, it's the lobby room smells right now.
Can I tell you something funny? Today, my mom said, "Oh, I watched The Lobby, and you guys are always ridiculous talking about how things smell or taste." And yet again, here we are, smell or taste.
That's great.
Well, we did just discuss a potential upcoming episode of The Lobby with our friend Olivia.
I'm very excited.
That will
about
include
it.
Both smell and taste and hilarity, most likely.
Yeah, I'm very excited about that one. Stay tuned.
So we had, you know what, I'm gonna wait, but don't let me forget, because I want this to be closer to the end. But don't let me forget to bring something up before the lobby ends.
I'll do my best.
Okay. Hattie wants me to forget it, so I'm not going to ask her.
I don't know what you're talking
about. I know, but
about.
You want me to forget it. But you don't want me to forget it. Okay. So make sure you remind me to bring it up in
I'm
a few
worried.
Minutes. Oh, man. We had a lot of chatting about baseball last week. That
People
was fun.
People were very excited about
they were.
Because we were at a baseball field if you didn't join us. My favorite is that we talked about hot dogs and stuff on the lobby, which we usually, spoiler, record on Monday or Tuesday of the week. And someone walked into our in-person campus on Sunday and called me Hot Dog Hattie. Yeah.
They had watched the 9:30 service.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Service just to see the lobby.
It's choking up.
I don't have any water with me. I think this might be the first lobby episode where I haven't had something to drink.
You always have a beverage.
Oh, man. I'm just getting really emotional.
Thinking about the episode of The Lobby where we talked about baseball
yes,
the whole time.
Yeah, I do love baseball. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, so they came to church because in Williston, we were just having a 10:30 service the whole month of July. Is that right? Yeah. And so you might be able to hear producer is cut to producer cam quick. Oh, he's gone. Where did he go?
He's doing a great job at producing. I hope all of those sounds are picking up right now.
This is sound month on the lobby. Can you tell what's going on by...
We haven't done anything with sounds.
Oh.
Except
I think we talked about sound month last week with the... thank you, producer.
You're welcome.
Oh, this is a fun mug.
That's a great mug. We used to have fun talking about mugs on the lobby also.
We did.
That
we did
hasn't
talk
happened
about
in
mugs.
A long time. That one is very cool.
It is. I don't know where this one came from.
Or but, what it is.
But anyway, so this person, it was, can we say who it was?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was our friend Carrie.
Hi, Carrie.
Yeah. And Carrie loves the lobby. So even when she comes in person, she usually tries to watch the lobby. And because you had the 10:30 service, she was able to watch the early one. Mm-hmm. And I get I was hosting online, and I get a text from Hattie. And she goes, someone called me Hot Dog Hattie this morning. I was like, what? Oh, the lobby.
It took me a second.
It was pretty great. It was pretty great. Yeah. We love when you guys pick up on weird things from the lobby.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. it's. But we also scheduled a New Hope. Well, we didn't schedule it yet, but we discussed a New Hope here campus trip to Target Field to watch a Twins game. So yeah, all of our
very
people
excited about that.
From New Hope here, we're all going to meet at Target Field and watch a Twins game.
That'll be fun.
Yeah. Yeah, that sounds lovely.
So if you would like to fund that, that's newhopehere.com/give.
There's
no drop down menu for that, but indicate on your Connect card that that's where you want to go.
So when is this happening? Can we pick a date and make sure that we go there?
It's probably going to be a World Series game, right?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Because as a Minnesota sports fan, our teams never let us down. So
you
we'll
know how fun that
would
be? Because
Series.
We all chatted last week about our favorite football food, or I mean baseball, so sorry. And then we would all be there with each other eating our favorite baseball food together.
That'd be pretty great.
People from California.
Montana. All over the place.
Washington.
Yeah.
We'll see you guys there.
Let's do it.
Yep.
Right, Pastor Mike?
He may or may not be in the room right now monitoring what's happening. All right. I think, because I'm not sure how long this is going to take, so we're going to go into it now.
Oh, don't forget to mention the thing.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Michael. Michael's a really good producer.
Yeah, he's really good.
Yeah. So in the lore of the lobby, I think we've only ever had to re-record twice. Because of technical issues, maybe three times. Once really early on, I remember we had to re-record. I believe Brendan did not record the audio. Uh-oh. Shout out to Brendan. And then, how did we screw up when we were filming on my deck outside?
Oh,
was it audio as well?
Did your microphone fall off?
Oh, yeah. That's what it was. My microphone fell off.
Yeah.
So that was
there
my
was
fault.
One time.
Shout out to me. And I think there was one other
time too.
So unfortunately, the first episode we filmed included one of the greatest stories ever told on the lobby.
I don't know what it is, though.
And that was you having a campfire.
Oh, jeez.
And it has never come back up. We forgot to bring it up when we re-recorded the episode, and Michael and I were filled with regret.
I thought it was okay to just like move past that.
The next best moment was in the fire station, and we forgot to bring it up there.
I actually thought about it in the fire station, but I certainly wasn't going to bring it up in my fire person costume.
I think that's true. That would have been, you would have been shamed wearing that costume while you tell the story.
Can you get like a ticket from something you did 10 years ago?
Well, I think everybody at New Hope here and Pastor Mike, who's also in the room, would like to hear the tale of your campfire.
So I was in college. I'll start with that. And also, poor college student.
A lot of qualifiers.
Right? Like when you're in college, who has money, extra money lying around for things? Not most people. So
like
I lived
shampooing
in
shampooing carpet. And
we didn't have carpet.
Fire extinguishers.
So I lived in a house with some friends, and it was like springtime, and we were wanting to save money on heat. And it was pretty nice out because it was springtime in Fargo-Moorhead area. And so we had this brilliant idea to bring in the fire pit from outside and put it in our living room to heat the living room. And I love starting fires. I feel like I'm good at starting fires. So I'm like, let's just try it out, you know, and it'll make it nice.
So terrible.
And warm. So I'm not really sure.
You were a college student when this happened.
I'm not really sure who agreed with me, but it was more than just me who was starting this fire in our living room. So we started it, took a couple of photos, which is why you guys.
Yes. I think this is where we will insert the photographic evidence of this activity.
You might have to find it first,
Hattie. It really recirculated this year for some reason.
Oh.
But what was really unfortunate is that we didn't think the smoke part through.
No! So, What?
So our living room got super smoky and we had to open all the windows. And then it was just freezing in our living room. So I learned some lessons that day. And people were really like, what are you doing? That's so crazy. I'm like, it's a contained fire. It's just like a fireplace.
It's exactly like a fireplace, which has a chimney to the outside.
Except
that,
for that.
It captures all the smoke.
Except for that. I see it now.
How did you put the fire out?
I'm sure we just like put some cups of water on it. I don't remember because it was college. Remember, a long time ago, I was still learning things about the world. And
I'll say. And what college was this that gave you a degree?
It was Concordia College. Yeah, in Moorhead, Minnesota. We were cobbers. I've said that a lot of times on the lobby. Yeah.
Oh, man. Please never start a campfire
in, even if in you want to save money, it won't
Can you play... Can you get the More You Know music from NBC? Don't start campfires in your living room if you don't have a fireplace. Your fire pit belongs outdoors.
Yeah, that's good. That's a good PSA for everybody. Even if
you get one, maybe you should get one of those solo stoves like we used when we were at my house. They're supposed to be smokeless. So there you go. Try.
See, I feel like...
Don't do that in your house either.
I feel like the flames is where... That's why people were saying, like, Hattie, you should
It was a bad idea for a lot of reasons.
So that thing also has flames. Your solo.
Yep, most fires have flames. Thank you. Hattie got a chemistry degree in college.
Biology, close enough.
You were a science major. Oh, no.
I wasn't thinking, clearly.
Well, thank you for joining us. I should have started this earlier. That was my bad. Let us know in the chat if you've ever intentionally started a fire in your home.
For warmth.
For warmth. Yeah,
or also, for other
you
reasons.
You said it was nice outside. Why didn't you just open the windows?
Not for,
well,
like,
I mean, it was nice enough, like, it wasn't snowing. But we still want
to... Yeah, not for, not for insurance. Oh, my word. Okay, let's wrap up before we get into arson admissions. But please don't post in the chat if you've ever intentionally burned something down.
There might be other reasons people have started fires in their
house. We need to move on.
I kind of want to double down.
We have a really great service today. We're never doing the lobby in the podcast room again. Our new series starts today, Axe More Than a Building. So if your building burns down.
We're sorry.
Oh, boy.
I can't even talk.
What's next, David?
We have a great service. Thank you guys for being here. Oh, we love all of you, and we will see you in just a minute. Well, hey, church, welcome to New Hope here. If you just joined us for the lobby, that's what the lobby is.
We're sorry. Yeah. I'm not sure what we say about that.
We love
that
hanging
one.
Out with you guys in the lobby. Do. And so I hope that you join us a little bit before the service starts.
We hope
so
you had a lot of fun with us, too, because we had fun.
Yeah, we did have a lot of fun today. And now our new series is going to get started today, Axe More Than a Building. It's going to be such an incredible series. We're so excited about it.
And we are glad that you are here joining with us today. And we are going to enter into a time of worship. So would you worship with us?
infinite and sweet. This love so rescuing. Oh, how infinitely sweet. This great love that has redeemed. As one we sing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is holy.
Well, hey, church, we just love that we get to worship with you every single week. And man, I'm just so thankful for our worship team. I always am. Thank you for leading us in worship today, Michael. And I know you love getting to do that for our New Hope Here family. And we want to encourage you to fill out a Connect card like we always do. And we want to encourage you to do that every single week because it's important. And it's the best way for us to stay connected with you, for you to stay connected with us. And so go ahead and fill that out. There's a link in the chat right now. You can always find that Connect card on our website or on our app. So even if you're not with us live, you can always find that Connect card. But if you have any prayer requests, if you have any questions about the church, you're looking for ways to get connected, you can do all that and let us know on the Connect card.
Yeah, and right now we want to encourage you to check out our kids service, even if you don't have kids. It's something you want to see. And if it's just this
one time. But especially if you do have kids.
If you do have kids, yes, go get a second device, click the link in the chat, and we have a service that's designed specifically for your children, preschool to elementary, and it's just a really fun time for them to learn kind of more on their level rather than Pastor Mike's teaching level.
So. Yeah, and now's like Michael was saying, now's the perfect time to get that started because Pastor Mike's message is about to happen. Before we get to that, though, we want to continue in worship by giving back to God his tithes and our offerings. And man, if you consider New Hope Here a part of your church, we hope and pray that you'll be following God and in that tithe and giving that 10% that's already his back to him. If you consider a different church your home church, we want to encourage you to give to that church. Right. You should tie it to that church. Excuse me, tithe to that church. That's kind of a tongue twister.
It is.
Tithe to that church. There's too many THs in there. But if you feel God calling you to give above and beyond that to New Hope Here because you believe in the ministry, you believe in gatherings, the things that we're doing here, we encourage you to go ahead and do that. But you can find all the different ways to give by clicking a link in the chat. You can see them on screen as well. Or you can always go to newhopehere.com/give.
Yeah, and before we go into the message, we want to pray with you. So let's pray together. Father God, we thank you so much for this day, and we thank you for the chance to get to worship together as a church family. And even though we're not physically together, God, we are joined together through you and through your Son. And right now we just ask that you speak to us through Pastor Mike's message, through the words that you've given to speak, and just let our hearts and our minds be changed today. And we just look forward to what you have to teach us. And so just be with us now. God, we thank you. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, welcome to New Hope Here. I know we've said that already, but I'm really glad that you're with us. It has been an interesting summer for us around New Hope. I know a lot of us are traveling this summer, right? I heard the other day they're calling it revenge travel. Basically, we've all said, don't tell us we can't travel this year. We're all traveling. I don't care what the gas prices are. We're all traveling. And on top of that, if you've been with us on New Hope Here, you know the lobby has been in a different place every week because our Williston campus building is getting some much needed repairs. And what's really cool is in the middle of all of this, God is stirring some new, some exciting, some real encouraging things in the heart of our church family. And we started out this summer talking about that when talking about our church plants and hearing from our church planters. And we're gonna end the summer that way. But because of all the changes in things, some of the things we had planned, in fact, some of the series that we had planned for this summer, we've shifted some things around, and the Holy Spirit has really been guiding us. And that's, in fact, that's part of what we're going to be talking about these next few weeks. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing for us. So today we're going to start a new series, and we're going to stay in this series as long as we need to this summer. We're calling it Acts More Than a Building. So if you have your Bible, turn to the New Testament, the second part of the Bible, fifth book in. After the name books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you have the book of Acts. And for these next few weeks, we're going to be in the first two chapters of the book of Acts. And the first chapter records this moment 2,000 years ago when Jesus, if you get the picture, he's on a hillside with his followers, those that stuck with him even through his death, the resurrection. They're around him. So the 11 disciples, obviously it's not 12 anymore, minus Judas, and a bunch of other men and women are around him. And Jesus, what they don't know is Jesus is getting just about ready to ascend into heaven. So these are his last words before physically leaving earth. And because he's God, he's being very intentional, very thoughtful, not just that those words would mean something to them, but mean something to us as the church 2,000 years later. And there's one phrase in here, one sentence in here that I want to kind of lift out of this, and this is the sentence that we're going to talk about for these next few weeks. It's an intriguing, and if I'm really honest, kind of a frustrating sentence. It's in Acts 1:8. Here it is. I'll put it here on the screen. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. As we begin this series, if you have your Bible open in a note-taking guide, I want to encourage you to underline those first few words. You will receive, and in particular, power. You will receive power. Basically, what Jesus was reminding his disciples, you've chosen to follow me. If you follow my leadership, if you follow what I've taught you, then you will live with the same power that you've seen in me and work through me. And if we fast forward over the next few pages in the book of Acts, we find that that's exactly what happened. In fact, just a few days later, the disciples are waiting for that promise to take place. They don't know exactly what it's going to look like. They're waiting for the promise to take place. They're in the upper room. They're praying together. We'll talk about that. They're waiting. They're kind of expecting, okay, Jesus, you said wait. You said wait. What's going to happen? And then look, in Acts chapter 2, verse 1, here's what it says. When the day of Pentecost, is 5, so it's 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire, this is getting crazy, that separated and came to rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And in that moment, if we begin to follow what happens, in that moment, we recognize that God's Spirit, the fullness of His presence, came into them, was with them. And from that moment on, we saw the power of God not only changing them even more than they've already changed, but working through them. And you see, you know, the same kind of miracles that Jesus performed, lives being changed, healing happened, people being raised from the dead, and those are the flashy kinds of things. But even if you kind of go below the surface, the things that we ignore but probably are more powerful, people who've been living a certain way under a certain belief system since the day that they were born, people who had never really changed, suddenly their lives changed, turned and went in a completely different direction. Entire families were turned right side up. God's power was unleashed on that day. God's power is something that I'm intrigued to talk about, and we're going to talk about that in these next few weeks. God's power is something that Jesus promised to the early church. We see it in the early church, and it's cool to watch, but if I'm really honest, it's also kind of frustrating. Because when was the last time you looked at a church, a gathering of people who said they're followers of God, and the first word that you thought of to describe them was power? Or it's just, you say, man, they're just filled with God's power. It's obvious. When was the last time... Let's talk about you, or if you're a follower of Jesus. When was the last time, if you're a follower of Jesus, that you looked in the mirror at the end of the day and you reflected on your day and the word that you thought of was power? Man, today was just, God's power was not just in me. He was just working through me. Sadly, not many of us would describe the church of today or ourselves as the church in its smallest form, as followers of Jesus, as being filled with His power and His power at work through us. We're going to talk about that for the next few weeks. Because wouldn't you love to put your head on your pillow at night and know that it's not abnormal, it's normal to look back on your life and you can just point to the fact, not necessarily every moment flashy things, but you can point to the fact that God's power is actively at work in you. So as we walk through this, we're going to examine what exactly brought that about. Can that still happen today? And some have suggested it can happen today, that it only was available in that way 2,000 years ago. I don't think the Bible proves that to be true. In fact, I think the Bible says exactly the opposite, that as followers of Jesus, His power at work in me and His power at work through me should be normal. But there are some things, there are some choices that we have to make that is not a list of things that we have to perform to somehow prove that we're worthy of it, but to put ourselves in the place where God's power can work through us. It's kind of like a garden hose. You can't turn on the water and then run to the other end of the garden hose and expect water to come rushing out of it if the hose isn't actually hooked up to the faucet, right? The hose has to be hooked up to the faucet. And the hose, all the hose does is make sure that it's in the right place. And that's the same thing for you and for me. We're just in the right place for God's power to work through us. So let's start. Chapter 1 tells us the disciples went back and they waited and they prayed. And then this moment happened. And when this moment happened, they were filled with His Spirit. They were filled with His power. And what happened to them is one of the first things that's a sign of God's power working in us. They couldn't contain it. They had to go out and talk to other people about it. So they left the room and they're out and they're talking to people outside of the room. And anytime God's power is on display, people begin to be drawn towards it. They begin to ask questions. And that Peter recognizes in this moment that here's people who need to hear about Jesus. They need to know His forgiveness. They need to know that His power is available in and through their lives. And so he begins to tell the story of Jesus. And the cool thing we just read is that everybody, even though they didn't speak Peter's language as their first language, everybody heard what Peter was saying in their own language. That's one of the flashy things of God. But what was even more amazing is what happens next. Peter tells the story, tells about who Jesus is to this group of people. And in verse 37 of chapter 2, it says that the crowd cried out at the end of his talk. And they said, "What do you want us to do?" I can't remember the last time I preached a sermon as a pastor and the crowd cried out and said, "What do you want us to do?" You know? And that's maybe part of where I'm wrestling with this myself. It's like, man, I want to live in God's power. I want to live where people are attracted to God working in me. Basically, God, the people are saying, how do we make this right? And Peter replied. He goes on in verse 8. He says, repent. That means change the direction of your life. Change what you're following and be baptized. Two things. We'll talk about this in a moment. Every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. In other words, what you're seeing in us can happen in you. And he goes on, he says, the promise is for you. It's not just for a select group of religious people. It's for you, your children, and for all who are far off. He wasn't just talking about geographically far off. He was talking about those who are spiritually far off. And for all whom the Lord our God will call. So here's what he says. If you want to experience this, the power that Jesus promised, two things. He says, first of all, make a decision. Make a decision. Make a choice about what you believe about Jesus. And what was true then is true today. There was a lot of people there who'd heard a lot of things about Jesus, and they believed a lot of things about who he was. Some of them had heard him teach. They'd heard all kinds of stories and things, and that's true today, although we have not physically heard him teach like some of them, but you talk to anybody, people will come up with all kinds of things about what they believe about Jesus. And a lot of people are kind of on the fence, you know. I believe this, but I don't believe this. I believe this, but I don't believe this. And Peter basically says, it's time to get off the fence. So now it's time to get off the fence. You can't believe in a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this. You can't basically say you have your philosophy and I have my philosophy and let's just tolerate one another. When it comes to Jesus, he says, This is what you need in order to live the life that your heart truly wants. He is who you need in order to live the life here and to have the eternal life that you were designed to live. You need to get off the fence. And I love this word picture that we use a lot today. I don't know if it's a Midwestern or Western word picture, but we use it most everywhere. Get off the fence. And of course, it depends on what kind of fence we're talking about, right? I mean, you're... A lot of us, when we say, some people just like to sit on the fence. Well, obviously, it's not a barbed wire fence because you aren't going to sit on that too long. You aren't going to sit on a picket fence because you sit on a picket fence, you'll soon get the point. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry. But there are some fences that are more comfortable to sit on than others, right? There are some fences we can sit on. We can just hang out here for a while and go, you know what? I like what's on this side. I like what's on this side. And Peter's saying, when it comes to Jesus, you can't live that way. You've got to make a decision. You've got to make a decision. You have to choose whether he is who he claimed to be. And if you believe it, then it changes everything. Listen, if you've never asked Jesus to be the forgiver of your sin, you need to understand that's why Jesus came. He didn't just come to teach some good things, and that matters, and we need those things. He didn't just come to show us that it's possible to live a good life. That matters, and we need to know that. Ultimately, he came because you and I have gone away from the life that we were designed to live. That's called sin, and we've all sinned. And we've all sinned in a way that has separated us from the life that we were promised, and there is a price to pay for it. And Jesus says, you don't have to pay that price. He died to pay that price for you and for me. This is what Peter was talking about. He was saying, you can be forgiven of your sin. Jesus will pay your sin debt. You don't deserve it. You can't earn it. All you can do is receive it. And you can do that right now. Right now, you can say, Jesus, I recognize that I have sinned, and so I ask you to forgive me of my sin. And right now, Jesus, I ask that you would come into my life like you came into the disciples' life and begin to change me like you changed them. These weren't religious guys. They were messed up. These were messed up, dysfunctional people that the world had kind of written off as broken people, just like a lot of us. And you can pray that prayer. In fact, you don't even have to pray with the words that I just used. You can just say a very simple phrase right now, me too, Jesus. And if you prayed that prayer, I want to invite you to let us know. In fact, we're going to put a link in the chat right now for you to let us know. And don't be scared of that. We won't hunt you down. But asking Jesus to help change the trajectory of your life by forgiving you of your sins, that's what Peter said is the first step. You've got to make a choice. He says, repent. That's make a choice. And then the second thing he says is get baptized. Get off the fence and publicly declare. And look at what the Bible records happened after Peter said that. He said, those who accepted this message were baptized. Can you imagine? About 3,000 people. I don't know how they did that in a crowd. 3,000 people became followers of Jesus, like some of you, I believe, have just in the last few moments. And this is where we need to have a conversation at the beginning of this series. We need to talk about this thing called baptism. Because for a number of you, you've said, yes, you know, I believe in Jesus. Yes, forgive me of my sins. But you have not gotten off the fence in a public way when it comes to Jesus. And so I want to, right at the beginning of this, when if you really genuinely want to experience the power of God in your life, he says, part of this is getting off the fence. And I want us to understand what baptism is and what baptism is not. We're going to walk through this fairly quickly. If you've got notes, you want to take some notes. If you want to go to our YouVersion app, we'll have that in there. If you're watching this on the Sunday where we're joining in live together. But here's what baptism is. Baptism is, first of all, we've already talked about this, getting off the fence. It's baptism is getting off the fence. In fact, let me put it this way. Baptism is the public declaration, the public celebration, the public reminder of our decision to get off the fence and follow Jesus. Want to guess what the key word is there? Public. Public. some of the last words of Jesus before the words where he talked about power to his disciples were these in Matthew 28. He says, "All authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples." In other words, tell everybody about what it means and what it looks like and why it matters to follow me. Make disciples of all nations. What's next? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. For years, I was bothered by the fact that Jesus, in what we call the Great Commission, he gives the same prominence to teaching as to baptism. In other words, pay attention and obey and be baptized. It's like, okay, why are those two things on the same level? And I realized as I dug into this that it's because baptism symbolizes publicly, the public line, publicly I'm saying I'm going to make the decision to dedicate my life to understanding and even more importantly, following Jesus' leadership, following his teaching. And we need to be clear about what baptism is. We also need to be clear about what baptism is not. This is not saying, and Peter was not saying, Jesus was not saying, that baptism saves us. In fact, you can write this down. Baptism is not what saves us. Baptism is not what makes you right with God. It's not what you do to say, all right, now I know I can get into heaven for free. We are not forgiven of sin by being baptized. That's not how we're made right with God. And unfortunately, some people believe that they're going to heaven just because some religious leader sprinkled some water on their head or maybe a few weeks after they were born. I need to tell you as your pastor, I need to tell you as your friend, that there is absolutely no biblical basis for the position that once you're baptized, it's a guaranteed ticket into heaven. So if you're banking on being a Christian and going to heaven because you got sprinkled with water or dunked underwater or baptized as an infant or as an adult, you need to understand the Bible does not promise that. The Bible says that what saves you is what? It says in Romans 10:9, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, in other words, it's what we just talked about, asking Jesus to be the leader of your life and the forgiver of your sin, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's a decision to trust him that saves you, not a decision to be baptized. See, baptism is the public, keyword, statement that we're no longer on the fence with Jesus. Put this in your notes. Baptism is not how we get right with Jesus. Baptism is how we declare that we're off the fence. It's, and here's second, baptism is a public picture of what Jesus did for me. It's a public picture of what Jesus did for me. And I'll put this in our notes too, so you can write this down. Baptism is what we call, and it's kind of the theological word, a sacrament. Sacrament is something ordinary that God uses to remind us of something extraordinary. We need reminders, right? I need reminders. Whenever I have an early morning flight, I have this fear of my alarm not waking me up on time. So I get a little OCD. I set like 2, 3, 4 different alarms, especially if it's not at my normal wake-up time, to make sure I wake up at time because I know that I need to be reminded. I know my body won't naturally wake me up at times. We need reminders. We need people to remind us. We write things down, especially as I get older. I write things down because I forget things. And God knows that we need a physical reminder. We need physical reminder moments to help us remember what's important. And that's, baptism is one of those things. Another one of those things is communion. It's a sacrament, something ordinary that we do that reminds us of something extraordinary that Jesus did. This is how the Bible describes it. In Romans chapter 6, it says, "We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." Did you catch that picture? We were buried with him through baptism. We'll come back. Into death, in order that just as Christ raised him, we were raised. Colossians chapter 2 says, "And when you were baptized, it's the same thing as being buried with Christ." In other words, it's a symbol here. You were raised to life because you had faith in the power of God who raised Christ from death. You get the picture. See, what baptism is, and this is why we immerse, we put people under the water. It's not the only way, but I think it's the most symbolic way. Going under the water is a symbolic way to identify with Jesus. He died for our sins. And so going under the water, you ever tried to breathe underwater? You can't. Why? Because you weren't made to live under the water. And so reminding us, you are not made to live a life without Jesus. You're going to die, not only physically, but spiritually without Jesus. So that's being buried with Him. That's symbolic. And when we come up out of the water and the water rushes off us, it's reminding us that He paid the price and He washes us clean. It's a symbol. It's not what saves. And baptism is just pregnant with meaning. Baptism declares my faith. It declares I'm off the fence. It illustrates. It's a picture of what Jesus did for me. It illustrates His death. It illustrates His burial. It illustrates His resurrection and the death of my old life and the new life He's beginning in me. It's a powerful reminder. Probably most importantly, baptism is a celebration of my new spiritual family. Think of it this way, and I'll put it this way in your notes as well. Baptism has been the primary means of publicly, there's that key word, publicly identifying ourselves as followers of Christ and part of being His church for 2,000 years. Time, culture, country, culture, all those things change. We sing different songs, right? We have different music. We dress differently. Our language, our traditions, all around the globe and around through time, they've all changed. But one thing has always been the same. Every follower of Jesus shares one thing with every other follower of Jesus for 2,000 years in history, around the globe, and until Jesus comes back. The one thing that identifies us all together is we've been welcomed into the family, and we celebrate that we're part of the family by what? By being baptized. Baptism is the public celebration that we have a new spiritual family. 1 Corinthians says this, some of us are Jews, others are Gentiles, some of us are slaves, others are free, but God's Spirit baptized each of us and made us part of the body of Christ. Listen to the words that Rick Warren wrote several years ago. He said, the moment you were spiritually born into God's family, you were given some astounding birthday gifts. A family name, a family likeness, family privileges, family intimate access, and the family inheritance. The Bible says, since you are His child, everything He has belongs to you. The New Testament gives great emphasis on a rich inheritance and tells us that our God will meet all your needs according to His glorious riches in Christ Jesus. So as children of God, we get to share in His family fortune. And here on earth, we're given the riches of His grace, kindness, patience, glory, wisdom, power, mercy. But in eternity, we'll inherit even more. And Paul said, I want you to realize what a rich and glorious inheritance He has given His people. And what does that inheritance include? We'll get to be with God forever. We get to be completely changed and experience His power in us. We'll be freed from all pain, death, and suffering someday when we enter into eternity. We'll be rewarded and reassigned positions of service, and we get to share in God's power working through us. It's an incredible inheritance. And baptism is the moment when we say, we've received His inheritance, we're part of the family. It doesn't make you a member of God's family. That happens when you ask Him to be forgiveness of sins. Our faith does that. Baptism is the celebration. Kind of like, my niece was adopted into her family. Now, she's not any less part of the family than any other member of our family. Baptism wasn't what happened when the judge signed the papers. That was the legal moment. Baptism for her, in a sense, was when we celebrated, we threw a party. Now she's part of our family. Baptism, in your notes, is a physical reminder of who my family is. It's kind of like the wedding ring. A wedding ring does not declare me to be legally married. A wedding ring is just a symbol, an important symbol, telling the world that I am married, that I've made that choice. It's a physical reminder of who my family is. It's a celebration that I now belong. Hebrews 2 says, Jesus and the people He makes holy all belong to the same family. This is why He isn't ashamed to call them His brothers and sisters. Ephesians 4 says, all of you are part of the same family. There is only one Spirit of God, just as you were given one hope when you were chosen to be God's people. We have only one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. Baptism is so important in the Christian faith. Baptism is, let's just do a quick review, getting off the fence. It's a public picture of what Jesus did for me. It's a celebration of my new spiritual family. It's the decision point. It's the decision point where anyone who wants to be part of the kingdom of God, anyone who wants to experience God's power, where it began publicly. You will not find in the book of Acts, in the history of the early church, a single person who they looked at and said, man, God's power is at work through him, who did not publicly say, I'm now a follower of Jesus. It's not how they became, it's how they declared it. It's not how they became a follower, it's how they declared that they were a follower. And that's an important distinction. Now I know, for New Hope here, it's a little bit of a challenge, isn't it? Because you aren't physically, many of you, most of you, aren't physically in one of our physical campuses. This is why starting a gathering is so important. It's why we talk about starting a gathering, so that you can have a gathering of God's people around you, to be on mission together, to celebrate being part of God's family together. And if you're part of a gathering, as part of how we can help you celebrate, you publicly declaring that you're a follower of Jesus through the act of baptism together. So if you aren't part of a gathering, maybe you can start a gathering. And just after I pray with us here, our team's going to come on and they're going to talk about how to be part of a gathering. But if you'd like to be baptized, maybe just a few moments ago you prayed to begin a relationship with Jesus, would you let us know? We aren't sure exactly how, if you live in another part of the country and aren't physically able to get here, but we'll help figure it out. We'll talk to you about it, because we want you to publicly declare that you're a follower of Jesus. Jesus said, but you will receive power when my Holy Spirit comes upon you. And I don't know about you, but I want his power at work in me. And whatever he says I need to tell the world about him, I'm going to do it, because I want the world to know what he did for me. Pray with me. Jesus, I pray that you would help us over these next few weeks to discover what it means to live in your power and to have your power work through us. And I pray for all of us across our church family, our church campuses and network this week, that you would help us. If we don't have a relationship with you, to make that decision right here and right now. If we do have a relationship with you but have never publicly declared that to our family and friends, help us to get off the fence and to publicly make that declaration. And if we have done that, help us right now. Challenge us, encourage us. Maybe we need to be the ones to start a gathering, start a group, to be the beginnings, the seeds of maybe a campus, maybe an eventual full church plant where we are. That's our dream, is that every person who's part of New Hope here would be part of a gathering of people, a family, on mission together. Help us to do just that. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Well, hey, church, again, we're just so thankful that you joined us at New Hope here today, and we hope that you found today's message valuable, and I encourage you to take a next step. And Pastor Mike was talking about gatherings at the end, and we always want to encourage gatherings as a next step for those of you that consider New Hope here your home church. And so if that's something that you've been thinking about, maybe you've been praying about it, or maybe today's the first time it's really come to mind for you, but we would love to talk to you about what it means to start a gathering, why we believe gatherings are important. And so there's a link in the chat right now. You can click that, fill out a really simple form, and it'll just let us know some information about you, so we can reach out and just talk. That's not a commitment form. Mm-hmm. That's just a let's have a conversation. You can also fill out a Connect card and just indicate, hey, I'm interested in talking about gatherings, and we'll reach out that way as well.
Yeah, and Pastor Mike spent some good amount of time teaching us about baptism.
Yes, he did.
And we know that there are some of you who are joining us right now that maybe you haven't been baptized before. Maybe you were when you were really little, and God is laying it on your heart to take that step and be baptized again. And we really believe that for people who follow Jesus, that is their first obedient step of faith that they can take. Kind of scary, but we we just want to encourage you to take that step of faith. And if you are located in a place where our campuses aren't close to you, we will help you. Yes. We'll help you find a place or a way to be baptized. So fill out a Connect card. Let us know. You can email David or Michael, and we'll get you the information that you need so we can help you take that step of faith.
Yeah, and if you still have some questions about baptism, we totally understand. And, and so if you want to reach out and ask questions about that, that's a great thing too. And the podcast tomorrow, if you haven't listened to Pastor Mike's podcast, it's called The Grow Podcast. You can find it on our YouTube channel, Apple Podcasts, or Spotify. And tomorrow's episode, the new episodes go out on Monday mornings. Tomorrow's episode, we just dive deeper into baptism. We ask a lot of questions that are often asked about baptism. So I really encourage you to check that out. And thank you again for being here with us. We love all of you so much. We're so thankful to have you a part of our New Hope Here family. And we will see you next week.